So just make sure they're extra strong when you buy them.
Community video originated largely in the 1970s when artivists, activists and community groups, largely misrepresented groups, started to take up this new technology to represent their own experiences. And they were sort of participants in front of and behind the camera. And that's what was very specific about this approach to filmmaking. Interest in AIDS activist video kind of was drawing this line between the early work I was looking at of community video in the early 1970s and through to the 1980s, where misrepresented or underrepresented groups were able to use newly available video technology to kind of make their own videos, to occupy the position of filmmaker but also a subject. And I think with the AIDS activist video research I've been doing through the Paul Mellon Scholarship, I've been able to sort of draw lines between the way in which those videos were made, but also the way in which they were treated once they were finished. Representation of the experiences of people with AIDS on television was really kind of marshalled by television, not necessarily people impacted or living that experience. And so there's a real discrepancy about what was being seen and then what was being made perhaps as well. I was invited to give a talk at Tate Liverpool, part of the Keith Haring Conference, and they asked if I could talk about that in relationship to AIDS activist video. And that was when I made this kind of naive assumption that there must be an AIDS activist video archive in the UK because there's this big one in New York. But when it came to look for that work, I couldn't find it. Since commencing this research, I've now located 18 AIDS activist videos in the UK made between 1983 and 1993. And I hope to make as many of these as available as possible through the London Community Video Archive. For me, whenever I think about archiving this work or digitizing it, I'm always thinking about how it can then be shown. I think with the history of community video, screening was always built into the production process. You never really press record without thinking who it's going to be for, who the audience is. And I think similarly with London Community Video Archive, for us, we're always thinking about how do we build an audience for this and what is the audience for this. And since doing this, starting this research, it's been interesting how many people have been interested in seeing this work. Partly because it's a large part of queer history that isn't really that recognised and that represented. And partly because these approaches to filmmaking still feel really relevant, and a lot of these videos still look like they could have been made yesterday. The way that the camera moves in a direct action protest, the way that someone who's experiencing the same thing as the person in front of the camera can then can ask the right questions or inhabit that experience and be sensitive to it. These things all still feel really relevant when you're making these kind of works. For me, it's really important that anything engaged in histories of activism needs to continue to be engaged in the present moments of activism. I don't want this just to be archival work, you know, looked back on. I want it to feel relevant and useful. I always think of this idea of urgency and intimacy. There was an urgency to it that was about the moment, about representing this moment. So there wasn't a lot of thought necessarily in this idea of the longevity of it. It was about responding to a moment. And I think you see that in the work, and the urgency kind of is, I guess, represented in the way the videos look and the feel of them, which is often a bit rough around the edges, a bit looser in the editing. There's a pace to it that feels like there was a necessity to it in that moment, because it was about saving lives.